Hello and welcome to Wildly Basic. I'm Denise McLeod and
I'm Whitney Hunt.
And we are here with a special guest who we see every week, actually.
Yes.
Really? Mr. Gary Allison is here.
I get to be special for a whole different reason.
Well, you are special, yes.
Yes.
For a good reason, which is a book, which I didn't even really know you were a writer.
Yeah, I've been writing, for 20 years, but I've been writing books now since 2013.
Okay.
Yeah. Not bad.
And how was that? That sounds like it's really super hard.
It's not hard. It's because it's what I do. But I can see, how you would think it's hard. It's a lot of work.
It's a lot of brain work.
Yeah, and I'm working on reserve, so
Yeah, because you do have a day job. So.
Right, right.
All right. So Gary's book, which is on Amazon's what list?
It debuted in the top 10.
Okay.
When it was released in January.
Excellent.
And, it's just holding strong right now.
Excellent. Good. It's called The Sinful by G.W. Allison.
That's right.
Yes. And it is becoming a hit, actually. There you go.
There you go.
There you go. Sinful. Well, I can put it in post, but
too bad. I already did that.
All right. But it's doing really well. Are you surprised?
Oh, I'm surprised.
Are you surprised?
Yes and no. I mean, it's a good book, so.
Well, I know it's a good book. Can you kind of give us an idea of what it's about?
Let's just say somebody that hasn't read this yet.
Yes.
No, I mean, I'm not saying I haven't read it yet, but I may not have.
I don't think he gave us one yet.
Yeah.
I mean, we
hey,
yet.
We help you out here, Gary. You gotta give us a copy.
All right.
It's a thriller. It's a noir thriller, which I'm a real big fan of. I'm a fan of those type of books. And my first two books were not noir thrillers at all. They were very dramatic pieces. Mm-hmm. My first book was a novella called There's a Season. It did really well, and it was a one-off. But a very dramatic, I tell everyone it's a sad romance story. And then my second book was about a boxer in the 1920s, based on a true story. Mm-hmm. And it did okay. It didn't do that well. I mean, there isn't a big need or a big desire for, period boxing books.
Right.
But, the fans of boxing and period stories like that
bought it. Well, you were new too, right?
Yeah.
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 So it's like your first book, you said?
My first book did really well.
Okay.
Okay.
And they actually made it into a movie. And it's a horrible movie, but it's a great book.
What is it? What was it?
So There's a Season was turned into a movie called Faith Under Fire that stars Dean Cain and Kevin Sorbo. Hmm? And that'll give you an idea of what kind of movie it is.
Like a movie of the week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's very Hallmarky and with really deep religious undertones. The book has some spiritual undertones to it, but it's not a religious book. Per se, it's not a faith-based book. It's just it's a plot device, and the producers turned it into a faith-based type movie. And it's not a very good movie at all. In fact, I said so plenty of times, enough to where the producers didn't even invite me to the premiere. So.
Oh, really?
Right. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you don't really have control, though, of that.
No,
though,
I don't
do
have
you?
Any control at all. No, I wrote the adaptation for that book, and then they took it and they did their thing with it. We went back and forth on a lot of things, and I made a lot of demands that were really meaningless because, like you said, I don't have any control on any of that. And the end result was not satisfactory to me.
Right.
So, and that's when I decided that I wasn't going to sell anything to independent producers or anybody outside of the studio system anymore. And so then I started thinking, I really want to write something that I want to read. And being a big fan of thrillers and noir-type books, I came up with The Sinful. And it's about a private eye in Detroit. And he's he is not a good man, but he's not a bad man. I tell people he's like everybody.
I was just going to say that's pretty much what everybody is.
Right.
Both bad and good.
Right? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I thought that was really important because most characters that you read are they're either really good people or they're really bad people, and there's nobody's kind of walking the shadows. You know, they may dip a toe in there every now and then. You know, may be forced to a certain aspect in their life where you know they're living in the gray world. And I wanted a character who was always in the gray world, and he was going back and forth between, you know, good and bad, and who actually sees himself as a bad man. And Leroy Cutter does see himself as a bad man. He was a former Detroit police officer that was forced to retire because of some questionable things that he did while he worked in the police department. And to make ends meet, he decides to become a private investigator, and only because he thinks it'll be easy. And that's the thing about Leroy, is that he wants to live the easy life. And by easy, I don't mean he wants to sit on a yacht and drink Mai Tais like I do. Mm-hmm. He wants to just be left alone. And so he lives on a houseboat, a really old houseboat in the Detroit Yacht Club, where he has trouble making rent. And that's because he just takes these jobs that just gives him, you know, petty cash here and there. And he comes off working an insurance job, he meets a woman at the docks named Barbara Goldman, who wants to hire him to find her sister. She's missing. And so he takes the job because he thinks it's going to be easy. An old friend of his threw it his way from the police department, an old lover of his. And so he thinks, you know, it's going to be pretty easy. It's a missing college girl, and she's just probably out, you know, gallivanting around, you know, mm-hmm. living a life, sure. you know, like college girls do. And Barbara seems very uptight and maybe a bit controlling. And she's very wealthy and maybe doesn't approve of her sister's lifestyle. And the further he gets into this case, though, the more he realizes that there's much more going on than just a missing girl. There's political corruption, police corruption. There's a family secret involved. There's drugs, gangs. And while all this is going on, he also owes a big bag of money to the Detroit mob because he's a degenerate gambler, mm-hmm. Which is another reason why he never has any money, because he's not a very good gambler. And so everything just kind of comes to head, and it's a bit of a rip from the headlines type story.
Right, sounds like mm-hmm. it.
Yeah, if anybody, especially people here in Detroit, if you're familiar with what's been going on in Detroit in the last 20 years, you're going to see a lot of familiar scenarios. In fact, a lot of readers have always said, hey, is so-and-so really this person and, you know, and things like that. And it's, yeah, they're based on that. I've taken headlines and created stories around them. And so it's a bit dark and twisted, but it's a fun ride and has a great ending. And it's doing really well. I'm really proud of it.
Excellent. Good, yeah.
But what I was curious about is how you come up with the ideas. Mm-hmm. That has to be the difficult part. Like,
yeah, what's the inspiration on that?
Well, I know you said the headlines are inspirational.
Yeah, right.
Well, that wasn't the inspiration. That came later.
Okay.
So I spent a lot of time down in the city. I love Detroit. I also hate Detroit, which there's a lot of that in the book also. There's this love-hate relationship with the city that Leroy has. And which I think a lot of people have, you know, it's a beautiful city. There's a lot going on down there, but then you have the politics of the city, mm-hmm. and just the greediness of the city the city's on a perpetual comeback. I mean, it's been on a comeback since 1968. You know, how long does a comeback last? And though some good things have, you know, happened in the city, you know, we see Midtown being built up. But it's at the expense of the surrounding neighborhoods in the city. Mm-hmm. You know, I can remember a time when going down the Cass Corridor, you took your life in your own hands.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now you go down there and it's like, you know, what I don't even recognize this place. You can walk mm-hmm. around freely and it's fine. But, you know, you drive 1-2 miles, you know, west or east from there and you're in trouble.
Mm-hmm. You're in a different world.
You're in a different world, absolutely. Yeah. And so, but I spent a lot of time in the city, and I never really read anything that took place in Detroit other than what Elmore Leonard had written. And if you're not familiar with Elmore Leonard, he wrote Get Shorty, and he wrote a lot of books that took place here in Detroit. And but you know, he passed, and he wasn't writing a lot. Well, not he wasn't writing a lot before then. He's especially not writing a lot now because he's dead.
Right.
But
he might be inspiring you from above.
Right. Yeah. And so I thought, you know, boy, I'd like to read a thriller that takes place in Detroit. Something, you know, everything takes place in L.A. or New York.
Right.
It seems. And I love those books. I really do, especially the New York ones. And I always thought, you know, boy, you know, Detroit's so rich. It would be great to, you know, have a story that takes place here. And so I started just thinking about that. And that's when the headlines came into play. I thought, oh, it would be neat if I kind of took this and did this and did this. But I didn't have a central character yet. And originally the idea was it would actually take place in 1968 during the riots. But that was a bit daunting. And I had a whole thing involved with Motown and all this kind of stuff, you know, that kind of correlates with Motown leaving Detroit and all this. And it's actually a pretty good idea, and it's still on the back burner for a different story. But I wanted something to be contemporary. Mm-hmm. And Leroy Cutter came to mind. And he was just a voice in my head. And, you know, not to sound crazy, but Leroy Cutter talked to me a lot while I was down there. And I just kind of got to know him. And, you know, he originally started off as a police officer. But I didn't want to write a police procedural. I'm not interested in those. I find them boring. Mm-hmm. And because there's a lot of those, especially on TV, people are very familiar with police procedurals.
You're interested in the other side, like the real, what goes on behind the scenes.
Yeah, right. and the dark side.
That's what I mean.
Yeah absolutely. Yeah. And so I settled on him being a private investigator. And but I didn't want him to be the super private investigator. I want him to be good at investigating, which he is. He's very good at investigating. He's a very smart person, but he just makes really bad decisions. And then on top of that, I want him to be lazy, and mainly because I am an inherently lazy man. You know, I will always find the easiest way to do something because I don't want to spend a lot of time doing anything.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And there's something, I don't mean this the way it sounds, but there's something a bit admirable about that.
That is true, because the lazy man will find the easiest way to do things.
Absolutely.
On the job.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And will add to the team by being able to do things easier.
Yes. Right. Yeah. But the other side of that is that sometimes the lazy man chooses the easy route at the peril of the whole thing, you know, because not everybody's on board with the easy way.
Yeah, that's true. Mm-hmm.
And you know, there's some corners that are sometimes cut, and you end up having to revisit. Which, as an inherently lazy person, I'm fine with, and Leroy's fine with also, because there are lessons to be learned in that. And so, so then once I had Leroy Cutter, that's when I got to work and started outlining the whole story, which is the longest part of the whole process.
Right, that's
right.
Yeah, and I wonder if it's like people who write songs and music, in that they get their ideas from a place they're not even sure where they're getting their ideas from.
Oh, sure.
Is it like that at all?
I mean, there has to be a correlation to that.
You know, like the Beatles, you know, they got all these great songs, but they got them from somewhere else. You know, they got them from somewhere.
Another
spiritually.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
I believe that anyway. I don't know. Is writing like that, you think?
Yeah, it can be.
Because you said you got to know the character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it can be. You know, I sometimes wish I was a songwriter, because you read those stories about those people who, you know, they're in the studio and they're told, you know, hey, you need one more song for the album, and they write their hit song in 15 minutes that everybody knows.
Right.
And I wish it was like that, but it's not. But there is a certain aspect to that. When you're writing a book, you spend a lot of time thinking about the book before you actually sit down and do any actual writing. Mm-hmm. What as people, what people think as writing. It's always writing, but before you even sit down and start putting down, you know, jotting down one word or anything like that, you spend a lot of time thinking about it. And that's the inspiration.
It'd be like a
part.
Puzzle, right? Mm-hmm. Putting together a puzzle.
It's a huge puzzle.
Like, is this going to work? Yeah. How is that going to work? And lead into that.
Right.
It's a huge puzzle, especially with a plot-driven book like a thriller.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had a giant spreadsheet, a grid sheet, that, you know, covered the span of this table. And across the top were the names of all the characters. And down the side were all the chapters. And then I would write in what was happening in each of those chapters for each of those characters. That was that's when it was really starting to get interesting. And that's where a lot of work takes place. And then once I had that, to be honest with you, I spent a lot of time really thinking about it again. And then, going to make some changes and things like that and make some tweaks. And then I sit down and write. It's back to your original question, if it's like songwriting, you know what is like songwriting? The beginning of the book and the ending of the book.
Mm-hmm.
That's what's like songwriting. You have that moment where you're just, this inspiration hits you, like, oh, this is how the book's going to open, and this is how it's going to end.
Mm-hmm.
And everything in between is, you know, mustard on the hot dog, man. It's great. It works out. And that's where that whole grid thing takes place, where you have your ending and your beginning and your ending, and then you figure out all the in-betweens.
Right.
And there is that aspect to it.
So when you're writing out that grid, what do you find hardest to fill in, like the personalities of the character, or which part is the hardest for you?
Well, the personality characters come out in the actual sitting down while you're writing. That's the secret sauce that you're putting in while you're writing. When doing the grid is just making sure that the plot lines up and makes sense. That can be, and the reason why I do that giant grid, because I've written two books prior to this. The first one I didn't do an outline for at all, and it was just, you know, just straight writing, and, you know, okay, but then this happens, and when this happens, then this, you know, as a result, this is what happens, and it just kind of went along that way, and that was a lot of fun. My other book, which was based on a true story, was a little bit different. It was outlining and a lot like that. That was a very long process. But what I realized is that I enjoyed the outlining process of knowing the story before I go in. And I guess that comes from my time as a screenwriter. You do a lot of outlining when you're screenwriting because a lot of people put their eyes on it before you even start writing a screenplay. So I took that idea and I put it into novel mode, and it was just making sure that the plot made sense. That's a real hard part, because it's easy to run away with it, because there's a lot of callbacks and things like that. You know, you don't want to give it all up front. You don't want to give it all in one big chunk somewhere in the middle.
All right.
You want to spread out nice and evenly to keep people turning the pages and wondering what's going to happen next. And so I think that's probably the most difficult part. And then the second most difficult part is actually finishing the book.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I read a lot. I read a lot of books. I try to read a book a week, and I run across a lot of books and I'm sure you've probably seen this if you're reading books, where you're getting towards the end and you realize, oh man, the author was just tired of writing this. It's a rushed ending. You know, they're just quick to get it to the end, and it leaves you unsatisfied.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't want that to happen. And so so that's because that does happen when you're actually sitting there writing it, and you know you're getting to the end. You're like, oh, man, I just want to wrap this up. And you have to force yourself not to do that and just play it out. Let it play out the way it's supposed to, so that the ending can be really satisfying for the reader.
Yeah. Do you like cliffhangers at all?
I don't. I'd like everything wrapped up nicely at the end.
Okay.
I do. But when it comes to plot, when it comes to characters, definitely. I want people to wonder, well, what happens to Leroy Cutter now?
Right.
That type of cliffhanger, yes, I do. But as far as the plot's concerned, everything wrapped up nicely at the end. Yeah.
All right. Awesome. All right.
You've done quite a few book signings.
Oh, yeah.
I saw on Facebook.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did. I did one at the Waterford Township Library, which, you know, it's funny. I don't like doing them.
Okay.
I really don't. I mean, people, this might be surprising to some people, might be surprising to you, but I don't do well with people. Because mainly because I feel like I don't want to say I feel like a phony, but I feel like I have to be on, and right. I don't like to feel like I have to be on.
Right.
You know what I mean?
I do.
And so when I went, I was there with another writer, William Teets, who's a fantastic poet. He's one of my favorite poets. In fact, he has a new book out called After the Fall. It's a collection mm-hmm. of poetry. And he's just wonderful.
And what's his name again?
William Teets.
Okay.
He's
okay.
just wonderful. And he's one of my top five favorite poets of all time. And he lives here right in Waterford. He's originally from New York. And I'm just very happy to know him. But he had a new book that came out, mm-hmm. his poetry book, and he called me up and said, hey, do you want to do a tag team here on for a signing and stuff and a reading? On top of that, oh, God, and a reading? Are you kidding me? I have to read? nobody wants to hear me read. So, so we did a book signing at Waterford, and I told William Teets, I said, I have – my worst nightmare is that no one shows up and that a lot of people show up.
Mm-hmm.
There is no win-win here. It's a lose-lose for me. And a lot of people showed up. I was very surprised, but I also knew, oh, geez, I gotta be on now.
Small talk.
Yeah.
I don't like it either.
And so I did my reading. I read a chapter, and then they had a Q&A afterwards, and then we had a book signing, and I brought like 30 books, and I didn't expect to sell that many. And I sold them all out and signed them all too. And talked to everybody and stuff, and actually had a really good time.
Good time. Yeah, you got out of your comfort zone.
Yeah.
Yeah, nice. It's a bit of a rule of mine. Yeah. When people ask me to do something, I say yes, even though I want to say no. And for two reasons. One, to push myself out of my comfort zone. And two, if you say no too often, people stop asking.
They stop asking, mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
That's true. Well, good for you. I'm glad you did that.
Yeah, and the other one we did at Bloomfield Township Library, which was really nice because that was Elmore Leonard's old stomping ground.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
So it was kind of cool to be there, and I sold a lot of books, did a lot of signing, and talked to a lot of weird people. It was a lot of fun.
No, you talked to some really good people.
That's what I meant. Yeah, good people. Yeah.
I was going to ask you something before you do that. I was going to ask you, I might put it in the front. I was going to ask you about your background because. You have a very big background. You like were in service, and you were like a roadie. And I was going to ask you, with all of the things that you've done in your life, is that where you get your characters from?
Oh yeah.
Well, it certainly is where I get a lot of the experiences from.
Right.
And I do pull from everybody I meet. I do pull from them certain aspects. For characters.
You must be good at watching people's behaviors.
I love people watching.
Yeah,
It's one of my favorite things to do.
Okay.
And, back when I used to go to the mall,
years ago.
Yeah.
Back then.
My favorite thing was just to sit there and watch people.
Yeah.
And then when I would actually make up stories about them, it drove my wife crazy. I would say, oh, look, that guy over there. And I would make this whole story about it. She was like, oh, you don't know that. I go, what are you talking about? It's perfect. It's clear. That's exactly what he's here for.
Right.
And it's a good thing to have, and it really does help the writing and being able to describe people and characterize them and things like that.
Do you have any advice for new writers?
Yeah. Write and read.
Just write
and read.
Rewrite and rewrite.
Just get your thoughts on paper.
Absolutely. So a lot of people tell me, I always wanted to write a book, and they say, can I tell you what I want to, can I give you an idea? And the answer is no. I have my own ideas. I have 3 pages worth of ideas that I, in my lifetime, I'll be lucky if I ever get through. So what I tell people is, first, if you want to be a writer, you need to read a lot. And I mean read a lot. Read good and bad books. If you want to be a screenwriter, read a lot of screenplays, bad and good screenplays, because you absorb that. And you get to understand rhythm.
It's a muscle memory.
Yes.
Thing.
You understand rhythm. You understand language. You understand length. You understand what rules can be broken. And you get to understand what the rules actually are. And on top of that, you need to write. And you need to give yourself permission to write badly. When I sit down to write a book, my job when I first sit down to write the first draft is to write that first draft as quickly as possible. I don't criticize myself when I'm writing. Even though I know I'm writing some really bad stuff, I just plow through it. Just dig that ditch. Just keep on digging that ditch. Because you're going to come back later and, you know, you're going to add the shaping and everything. You're going to pull stuff out. You're going to put new stuff in. And, you know, that's the hardest part is to be able to just push through it and get that first draft done. You have to give yourself permission to write badly. Mm-hmm. Because I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're Ernest Hemingway or James Patterson or Patricia Cornwell or anybody. When they sit down to write their first draft, they're writing a really bad draft. There's no way around it. Nobody's, you know, you see in the movies when a writer sits down and go, and the end. Yeah. It's done. Oh, thank goodness. No, that never happens. That's like the fifth draft, you know, where you're like, oh my God.
Writing is rewriting or something?
Like absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. And to the point where you're sick of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You probably have to get up and leave it for a week or something before you can come back and
It's a couple weeks. Yeah. After my first draft, I put it away for a couple weeks.
Yeah. It is like an art. It is an art form.
Well, yeah, because I mean, I think
like
if you don't take
it's like music. It's
well, yeah, because if you don't give yourself a break, then your brain's going to overload, and it's just not going to focus on what you're doing.
You're not going to be objective about what you're writing if you don't take a break.
That's a true danger, and it becomes noise. It really does. It becomes a lot of noise. You can't tell the difference between
it's frustrating, probably
good and bad.
Oh, sure. Yeah, you'll drive yourself crazy. So your dedication in this book is to your father.
Yes.
So you say this book is for my father, the baddest man I ever knew.
Yeah.
Why did you do that?
Well, my father passed away in, 2021. My father was a police officer for 30 years. And, you know, he was a police officer in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s. Those 3 decades are very different in law enforcement years. In the 70s, when I started out, police officers carried blackjacks or saps. They're also known as saps. They're just little leather, lead-filled things that they, knock upside somebody's head. They're horrible things. They're against law now to use. And then getting into the 90s, you know, it was pepper spray. You got pepper spray. So, it was very, very confrontational to avoiding confrontation type thing. And my father was a very tough man. He was a very tough police officer. He won a Medal of Valor, or he was awarded. I don't know if he won it. He was awarded a Medal of Valor for saving a woman during a shootout. He was willing to get down and dirty with anybody, for the sake of the law. He was a very good police officer, but my father was also a very tough man at home as well. And, we all have our stories of growing up and stuff. And my father was very tough on me. It shaped me into who I was as well. And a lot of things that I had to, embrace and a lot of things that I had to overcome. Throughout my life. And that's why, I say he was the baddest man I knew. I don't say that he was a bad parent. He wasn't a bad parent. He was just trying to figure it out, as many of our parents were, in the 70s.
Sure.
They didn't know anything from Adam. My parents were very young when they married, when they had me, and they were just trying to figure it out. And back then, as soon as you were able to walk, they were like, out of the house. We'll see you when it starts getting dark. And they didn't know what was going on. And what was very odd about him is that he had this job where he was very confrontational. It was a job that required confrontation. But outside of the job, he avoided confrontation. So it was this, duality of my father.
Oh, yeah.
But then when it came to me, and my sister, you know, who were younger, you know, you confront. And later in life, when I became an adult and I didn't give a shit what he said, you know, I was able to actually point that kind of stuff out to him. Go, mm-hmm. you know, hey, you know, you do this and then you won't do this. And, you know, and we ended up having a very good relationship as adults. But as a child, I was very afraid of my father. Just because, you know, he was a different breed.
Right.
He was mm-hmm. a different breed.
Right.
Those men back then were different.
You had to read them probably when you got home. Like, right. How, well, how's he going to be tonight when he gets home?
Right, yeah.
Yeah. And so, you know, I learned to admire my father later on in life. And he passed in 21 before this book was even written. It was just really in the beginning stages of it. And I decided that I would dedicate it to him because there's a lot of him in this book as well. You know,
is he in your main character or is it just a general, you know?
He's kind of spread out.
Okay.
Yeah, he's kind of spread out. I try not to put too much of one person into one character.
Sure.
Because then people go, hey, is that me?
You know, yeah.
No, it's not you. You know,
yeah. Very good. All right. So where can we get Sinful? You said Amazon, right?
So, yeah, Sinful is available on Amazon. Right now we are working on the audio version of the book. So for all you people who love audiobooks, it will be coming out soon. But it is available on Kindle, paperback, and for people who like to spend money in hardcover.
Mm-hmm.
It's also up for an award for Thriller of the Year.
Excellent.
For the Maxie Awards.
Very good.
It's a finalist right now.
Congratulations
so
nice. On that.
We'll see what happens with that. It's a good book. It's not it's thoroughly satisfying. Everybody that's read it so far, except for one person who gave me a 1-star.
Really?
How dare they?
But did not write a review.
Oh.
So it was on Goodreads. And the great thing about on Goodreads is that you get to see who leaves your ratings.
Mm-hmm.
And so I saw that this person left me a 1-star rating. And I sent him a message and said, hey, thanks for reading The Sinful, even though you thought it was a piece of crap.
Did he write you back?
No.
Of course not, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
No. But, you know, I get it, man. You know, I read books. Some of my favorite authors write books that I hate, you know.
Right.
So, you know, it's not everybody's cup of tea. I've had some people who bought this book and who loved my other books, mm-hmm. my other two books, and that's the reason why they bought this. I have told them, this is completely different.
Right.
So, you know that going in because, you know, I'd say there are some there's violence, there's mm-hmm. Language, and there's some adult situations that that are very dark in this book, and you know, and traumatic for some people. So that's a fair warning there.
Okay.
Yeah. So
let us know if you're going to do any more sightings, and we'll post that for you.
All right.
What's your website?
GaryWAllison.com.
Fantastic.
Very good.
All right.
Very easy.
Nice to talk to you today.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks for coming in. Appreciate it.
Bye-bye.
Bye.